co-chair of the Brookfield Agricultural Commission, and we would like to welcome our guest speaker this evening, who is Jim Metcalf. Jim is a beekeeper from the town of North Brookfield. I don't believe that we have any pressing business that we need to take care of, so I think we can go ahead and turn the program over to Jim.
All right.
You want to get that one off? Who is this one?
Yeah. If you don't mind, I'm going to not stand on this sit a little bit. Last week I was up to Hannaford with a basket and my cane, and a woman just ran the hell out of me and fractured my ankle.
Grocery cart.
Then she gave me hell. Her boyfriend said, "You hit the old man with the cane." And she says, "He backed into me." So, yeah, that was all right. You know, when I got home and I couldn't walk, I fell over and fractured ribs. So, right now I'm just going to limp. Sure. I want a smart track. What we want to do?
That may not be a good idea.
No.
Try again.
Okay.
You don't want that to close.
Well, the rug is kind of soft. What I want to do is Clarence asked me if we'd talk just a program on starting up beekeeping and stuff, because we got Mr. Grimes here, and it's about time somebody told him how to start beekeeping.
That's right.
So, he's been doing it for a lot of years. He's very good at it, but we'll give him some hints and stuff. Start off with a couple of hives. The ones over on the left, that's my favorite hive ever. We've been doing this for about 40 years, and that hive is in the mountains of southern Poland. We visited a beekeeper there. And I just identified with that old hive because it's just an old log hive with a face on it. And he's sitting there on a rocking chair. And the bees come in and out of, there's a hole somewhere right here. And this guy runs something over 2,000 or 3,000 hives, but he also runs all these antique hives. And so you can see some in the back are logs with faces carved in them, and he's got all kinds of really neat stuff and stuff. So we keep in touch with him, and I just want to show you that this is my favorite hive of all time. If I could have got that home in my suitcase, I think we would have brought it. This one next to it was a young woman who's just starting beekeeping in North Brookfield, and she called us, my wife and I, down to take care of the, and you see the front of it is just covered with bees. And the funny thing about this hive is she had a young girl staying with her that was addicted to this TV show or movie, TARDIS?
Doctor Who,
okay. And so they painted the hive as the phone booth and stuff. So it was pretty neat. But that hive had something like 250 pounds of honey in it. I mean, it was just locked full of honey. So we were in there. They were really angry at us trying to take it out to give them some space and stuff. But I thought you'd appreciate that hive a little bit. This one, I got to embarrass Clarence a little bit, because this Clarence and the town officers here, they were hiring a new bookkeeper, and of course Clarence can't spell that well. And so the ad went in for a beekeeper. And it embarrassed all of us that came over to apply for the job, because we thought Brookfield would be hiring a town beekeeper. Didn't work out that way. What I think I want to do, I'm not sure how many of you actually ever want to start bees, but I just put a list of things, you know, how much does it cost, and where do you get the stuff, and how do you put them in, and stuff like that. And I'll run down through it, but this isn't a presentation. Let's just ask questions or offer advice or do whatever, and we'll go through it. And maybe we'll get you to start bees when we're all done. The first thing is, why do people start bees? You know, why do it? I'm convinced that there's a number of people just do it to irritate the neighbors. You know, just get them and then say, no, it wasn't my bees, it stung you, or can you prove it? But a lot of people do it for the honey, and you can see just with this display of honey, it's really kind of neat, because in some ways it goes by the season. This first stuff up here, this clear water white, is locust, black locust honey. And then you move into the berries and apples, and then you move into the dandelions, and all the wildflowers through the midsummer. And then this stuff is probably buckwheat. You know, it's a very dark honey and stuff. And in fact, that guy that I showed you, his hive in Poland, what they do primarily is, they call it woods honey, but it's not honey from flowers. They live way up in the mountains, and it's honey from aphids in fir trees. And it's black as the ace of spades, to us, it tasted like walnuts. I didn't care for it that much, but in Germany and a lot of Eastern European countries, it's a real delicacy, the dark stuff.
Jim, do you think that, on a serious note, from a farm business perspective,
yep,
that there is capacity? I mean, Donnie's busy and those kinds of things. Given that you get down the health aspect of the pollen and allergies and all these kids with allergies,
yeah,
is there an angle there that you could actually say local stuff is important and make a buck?
You probably can. We've always been reluctant over the years to say honey, well, if you take honey you won't have allergies or stuff. I mean, it's kind of a medical claim. You really hate to,
right,
say that. It's the same thing. We've had people, I don't know if they come to you, they want to be stung for arthritis.
Yeah.
And so I remember my father years ago came to me and says, you know, I got arthritis in the shoulder, I got to be stung. So I looked it up, and you got to do like 30 stings every couple of weeks. So I stung him with one bee. He says, that pretty much does it. I'm
I did the same thing to my father. He had tennis elbow.
Yeah.
I stung him, and it wasn't too many. And he'd say, oh, I'm all.
And I'll do it. So, but then, you know, I mean, we were doing it as a hobby, and then when I retired from the company, some people in the company built us a website as a joke, and then we started getting calls all over the place. So we had been running up around 60, a little over 60 hives at one time, you know, pollinating all the places around, running them out on flatbeds. But we're not a big mechanized operation, so you're handling each one of those boxes yourself, and she and I are doing it in the middle of the night, those things will weigh a couple hundred pounds each one. So, but there's a business to be had. You're not going to get rich at it. Some old beekeepers won the lottery, and people asked him what he was going to do. He says, I think I'm going to stay with beekeeping until I run this money out.
A lot of times, like you say, we don't say that it's good for, you know, medical things like allergies and stuff, but 99% of the time people come up and say to you, oh, that's good for allergies.
Right.
So if they, you know, they hear it, you know, you don't say, oh yes, they, you know, well, yeah, you hear, yeah, that, you know.
Although we sell a ton of 5-pounders,
yeah, for allergies,
in the fall, that, yeah, these snowbirds are taking to Florida, and they're taking,
yeah,
they tell me they're taking 2 teaspoons a day, yeah, all winter, and,
yeah,
and they swear by it.
I don't swear.
I used to take the shots and all that kind of good stuff.
Yeah.
Since we've done it, you're stuck.
Yeah.
I don't have an issue.
Yeah.
Yeah. So It's just you can't, you can't make the claim.
Yeah, you can't.
Okay, all right.
They, one of the things you gotta think about is these legal neighborhood, all kinds of issues. You know, where do you put bees and so forth. There's a lot of Central American, Central American and South American places that put them in platforms way high in the trees. When they put them on the ground, they get elephants trampling over them and all kinds of bad stuff. In fact, I saw some pictures in Africa that they actually use beehives as elephant fences. And they'll hang these hives all around their gardens, and the elephants don't dare come through the hive. So it's something to think about if anybody's bothering your garden next spring. The new thing is restaurants have to have beehives on the roof, or in this case, in this French restaurant, there's two hives on the second floor window that they have to get to them through the window. But the thing is the restaurant uses the honey, and it's, you know, it's a delicacy, and on and on and on. And so, you like a lot of towns have right to farm laws, so really people can't necessarily chase you off, but you gotta be reasonable about this. Bees come straight out of the hive and until the first opening in the tree cover, and then they'll go up, lock onto the sun, and go in their direction. But when they're coming straight off the hive, if you're standing there, they'll hit you right in the forehead. They ping you. And if you don't move when they ping you, then the next ones through sting you. But they'll always, so if you get hit in the forehead, you know that that's your warning shot. You know, you gotta kind of move out of the way. Everybody claims that they're allergic to bee stings. And percentage-wise, it's a very small number, but everybody claims they are, they are. In fact, not only bee stings, but there's, up in Bell River, there's a big, big commercial operation, Merrimack Apiaries, we've been buying bees off them for years and years. Well, all these new homes have been built up around the farm, and there was one neighbor went to the town and said the bees are crapping on his house, you know. And so he wanted them shut down. And he was, you know, and they're still fighting that one out, because right now, the people from Belrica, they're wintering their bees in Louisiana, but they'll be back up in April and May and stuff. But if you can imagine that, I mean, it's like that place near Gloucester.
They did the same thing out in Amherst to the guy with a farm. They built up all around them. He had a sawmill, he had the dairy farm, and this was in the news, I mean, 5 or 6 years ago.
Yeah.
And the same thing. The guy was a dentist from Boston, moved out here. You know, when they came out and looked, the sawmill was never running. But he ran the sawmills on Sundays. So they get out there, they start living there, and the sawmill's chugging away.
Right.
And, we can't have that.
Now, in Georgetown, Mass., they passed a bylaw a few years back that if you keep chickens, you got to take the voice box out of the roosters, because you can't. I don't know if that's still in place or if whatever, but they actually passed the, you know, no roosters anymore. So people get a little crazy. They love driving through our towns, you know, and smell the new hay and stuff, but then if you spread in some manure,
Yep. Like a lot of times you try to put them out of sight, out of mind, because once they find out that you have bees, every bee, no matter if it's a honeybee, yellow jacket, or wasp,
oh, it's yours. Yeah, absolutely. All we recommend to people that are starting is try to be a good neighbor. Definitely give a jar of honey away to the neighbors, you know, or candles or something, you know, just And an old beekeeper from Rutland taught me how to get rid of all the yellow jackets and white-faced hornets. Because he used to get hired by like the fair, Spencer Fair, Northampton Fair, to rid those places of all these wasps. So that when the fair came, you know, the kids with cotton candy and stuff wouldn't have bees. And a lot of you probably know how to do it, but you take a can of cat food, as long as it's meat cat food, and you put in a teaspoon of seven, that insecticide seven, and you mix it up good, and then cover it with some hardware cloth or something so that the wasps can get in, but the neighbor's cat can't. And usually put it up high. I did it for the, you can't call it a dump anymore. I did it for the North Brookfield Transfer Station. And, you know, because they were getting, when people brought glassware in the fall, it was all kinds of wasps and stuff around. So we hadn't been bothered by it. But you could, you know, if you're keeping bees and you can rid the neighborhood of some of this bad stuff, you can be a little bit of a hero. And where to put them. I already talked about they come straight out of the hive, and then they go high, walk onto the sun, and get a fix on where they're going. So you got to put them so that nobody's really walking. There's not a sidewalk or a path or something in front of it. Some people even put a board fence or a high hedge so they have to go up and over. If you're keeping bees, this winter time is go out and stand in the field where you think you want to put them, and like at noontime, and just get a feel for the wind and the sun, and because this will be the worst time of the season, the cold winter. You want them so that there's some sort of a windbreak, keeping them, you know, the wind from just rocking them around. The sun comes in, that you can get to them, easy access, and a water source. Because if you don't provide them water, and when we go into, you know, if we're setting up on somebody's vine crops or something, we'll take 5-gallon pails and just put a pinhole in it and put the 5-gallon pail, you know, to give them water. Because otherwise they're going to go into the neighbor's bird bath or swimming pool or something. And we had one woman that spent all day rescuing our bees with a net from her swimming pool. She was the nicest old lady, but she just kept taking them out, putting them in the sun and letting them dry off and stuff. And nowadays, we were talking about it before, but you have to put a bear fence up. There's no doubt about it. I mean, when we're in remote locations, we're using solar-powered fences. They're not as strong, but we bait them with peanut butter. You put peanut butter in a little envelope of tinfoil and hang it on the fence. And the first thing that happens is the squirrels and the birds can land on the fence, not get zapped, and they can kind of dig at the peanut butter. But if the bear comes in, they'll try to lick open that envelope and they get a pretty good jolt. This is the bear we were talking about. This bear just got shot this past fall and he weighed in at 415 pounds. Here he was about a little over 300. My wife's brother's a bear hunter in Maine, and he looked at the picture and he says you can tell the weight of the bear by the ears. He says the only thing that doesn't grow on a bear is their ears. It's the same size when they're small or when they're big, so the body grows up by them. So you can see his ears are almost not being seen. But you can see the strands of the electric fence and the cameras on the beehive. You know, you kind of keep it there to see who's bothering and stuff. I assemble this thing as a kind of a list of what does it cost, and it probably nowadays, if you went to buy everything, it's probably pretty close to $1,000, you know, to start up. It could be more than that, but you know, you've got to buy a suit and gloves and a smoker, and nowadays you've got to put about $300 in for an electric fence and a charger and all that stuff. The bee boxes themselves, I'll hand out after a sheet of paper where you can get some of this stuff, but the bee boxes, there's a guy in Spencer that makes them, there's a guy in Oxford that makes them now, and they do a pretty good job. Or you can buy them, you know, through the mail from Humble Abodes and so forth in Maine. Medications, got to have, pails for the honey. Bees are getting very expensive. It used to be we'd buy them for, what, $30, $40, and now it's like $150 for a 3-pound box of bees and a queen. And most times, they're not any good. You know, they down south, they'll push a queen into it very fast, block it up, you know, ship it north to sell it, and we'll have to replace the queen almost instantaneously because they're just doing it mass production, I guess is what I'm trying to say. You buy used equipment, but I'd advise you to talk to the state bee inspector, especially now. As of January 1, across the country, a law's been passed that all ag people, you know, the pork people, the beef people, and they include us as beekeepers, you can't use the antibiotics unless you have a vet come out and give you a prescription. So it means you definitely, you know, you got to go get a vet to come out and look at bees. And I don't know what a vet knows about, you know, American foulbrood, which is the disease, but it's a very, very contagious disease. And people over the years have always used antibiotics to kind of suppress that. It doesn't eliminate it, but it suppresses it. But now with the new law, just went in January 1, you can't use that without a prescription. So you actually have to get a vet to look at your hives and then get a prescription and get it. So you can see the dollars add up on that stuff. And the other thing is, there's a lot more people building stuff today. And one of the things they're building is, they call them long hives or top bar hives. They come out of African countries. It's a long box, and inside the box is a series of really sticks that go across, and what you do is you put a little piece of wax on it, and the bees build it down, like you see here, they build it down into, you know, to fill up the space. The downside of it is the stuff we use with frames, we can get the honey out with an extractor. This stuff, you have to crush it up, you know, so you need a press, like a wine press or something, to crush it up. But a lot of people are using this. In fact, as we get old, you're still a kid, but as we get old, we can't carry those 100-pound or 200-pound hives any longer. So people have been advising us to change over to these kinds of things, or to take a regular beehive, instead of having a full box, you have two half boxes. So instead of 100 pounds, you get 250s, you know, you can take off. So it's just, you can't change out all your equipment over the years. I mean, if we had to do all over again, it might be the better way to go. And then the question is, where do you get the bees? Well, if you've got a lot of nerve, you can do this. What you can do is hook a queen right under your chin in the little box, and the bees will just cloud you over. And then if you can shake them off into your pocket or a box or whatever, that's one way to get it. Or you can, you know, get swarms. Whoops. swarms like this, picking them off out of trees. And there's a lot of beekeepers that put, they call them bait hives, but they take an empty hive and just have some wax in it or frames and just have them around in trees around their apiary. And the chances are fair that if the bees swarm in May or June, they might be able to catch them and bring them in. So that's one way to do it. The other way is to buy one of these packages. There's 3 pounds of bees in here. There's a can of syrup in the middle. And just on the edge of it, in the middle of that, there's a box with a queen in it. So they fill these boxes up with funnels down south in Georgia. They're on a scale. They just shake the bees in them until the scale reads 3 pounds. They throw the can in, the queen, and staple it up, and it's on its way. And what we've always bought over the years are what's called nucleus hives. And this is, it's already 5 frames of bees in a box. So you can, a package of bees probably is not going to produce honey the first year because they've got to build out the wax and yada, yada, yada. Whereas a nuke, you got 5 frames started, so there's a good chance you can get honey even the first year. So, but the prices on these nukes are getting way high now and going up almost 150. I've seen them going close to 200 and stuff in some places. Just where to get equipment. This is Baker is this young man in Oxford. LaPierre is the young guy in Spencer that's doing it. And somewhere, if you want to just hand around those sheets of paper that everyone, these are all kind of the places where you can get equipment and stuff. One of the places where we've always bought woodenware is this place, Humble Abodes in Maine, because it's just down the road from where we got family. We were up there, 2-3 years ago, they had a winter storm, and the snow load on the roof just collapsed the whole building. And of course, the state wouldn't let them reopen unless they brought the whole building up to code, and so they sold the operation to Betterby, which is a supplier in, up around Saratoga, New York. So they own it, but they just make excellent, excellent stuff. In fact, they'll make boxes any size you want, this Humble Abodes. And just another thing, when people will ask, well, how much time does it take? Don't you just put them out on the field and then come back in the fall and put the jar, empty jar under the spigot and just fill it up with honey? And it doesn't quite work that way, but it's close. In our locale, roughly you got to figure we only have 13 weeks a year of blooms and honey producing time, you know, when you count rain and everything else. It's about 13 weeks. And then there's about 39 weeks where the hive has to eat what they supposedly produce. So you can't necessarily take everything they've got. You got to leave them about 100 pounds of honey at the end of the season so they can get through that 39 weeks. Well, you know, honey as well as pollen. So that's the beekeeping year in New England. The more hives you have, the less you check them because you've got to keep running between them. It used to be nice when we only had one or two. You could sit in front of them, and we had one little girl who used to pat the bees as they came in. And I just never figured out she'd never get stung, but she would. They'd land and she'd just stroke them once and they'd walk in and stuff. She's a big engineer now, but But we usually check ours, try to check ours, sometimes weekly when it's, when they're, you know, starting off, or when it's extra dry, or in the winter. Like today would have been the first day they would have been flying in 17. It was just warm enough today that those boxes got up. As soon as they get about 50, 55 degrees, the bees will come out of, they're in a ball, and they'll come out of the ball and move to where honey is, or they'll even come out. And the nice way is to say they defecate.
Oh. A cleansing flight.
Cleansing flight, that's even better. That's even better. And then what do you do with all the honey? If you do a lot of it, you can sell it. If you don't do a lot of it, you can give it away. Or you can put it in church fairs. You know, we, tons and tons of our stuff goes to you know, various fairs and stuff, as donations. You can make hand cream, lip balms, candles. I used to, my wife kind of got after me. I used to just call it hooker's wax, because people would say, well, really? But it's rug hooker's wax, is the correct term. And then, what are your questions? Like, you didn't ask me why we keep bees, but we actually keep them for the wool. And we shear our bees in the spring, and then it's cold this time of year, so we knit them, these little caps. So that's the reason they don't let me teach in bee school anymore, because people would always ask, well, why do you raise bees? And you tell them, and you tell them, and you tell them. So then we finally, oh, well, we raise them for the wool.
You're not the only one. Barbara McPhee does, too.
Yeah, Barbara. Yeah. So this is one of our bees with one of the things
so
that we did. It's a nice little scarf and stuff. The other thing, I'm not sure if any of you are interested, but the Worcester County Beekeepers is about 700 members, and they do a bee school that I'm not allowed to teach at anymore. But it's going to be in Sutton at the high school, and this is just the info on it. In fact, this year is the 75th annual bee school, so we've been doing it for a lot of years. There's a fee for a family or something, and but it really is, it's pretty good. And so if you're interested, it used to always be at UMass Medical School. The medical school got too small for it, because they had to turn people away last year, so they're down in Grafton, and they figured it can accommodate more than the, normally they were doing 300 in the class, so this will, you know, they'll be able to go up to maybe 400, 450. So that's available. The other thing is the club itself, the Worcester County Beekeepers, we meet monthly. During the winter, we meet in Leicester at the Knights of Columbus Hall, and like there's a meeting Friday night, it's a potluck supper. Any of you are welcome to come. It's at 6:30, it's like a, you know, typical old New England potluck supper, there's a person talking about flowers and plants, bee gardens and what. So it'd be interesting if anybody's interested. You're more than welcome. Questions or? Well, I want to thank you. This is again my favorite hive in this time of year. The beekeeper sent me a picture of it. It's snowing on it. But that's some of his other antique hives he's got up and around. This is really neat stuff. And they all are full of bees. And this thing is amazing, because this guy gets all these school kids come with, in buses, you know, from the local elementary schools, and they're just walking around and it's amongst the bees, you know, no nets or anything, and he's showing them and getting a handful of bees out, and they're, you know, dipping, hunting, and all kinds of stuff. So if you did it here in the States, I think you'd probably be arrested or stuff.
Does he make mead? Polish mead?
He did, because he gave us a bottle, a couple of bottles.
So good.
Yeah. Yeah. Plus there's a mead that they make with green alcohol. It's called spiritus. And that's, I tried some the other day. It's just, a cold won't even come within the same room as it.
Cures for the old.
So, any questions? I don't want to, you know, keep you here all evening, but I wanted to chat a little bit about it, and, you know, just ask Mr. Grimes if he could. I must have did okay.
Well, you did perfect.
But you need to meet Steve. He needs hives.
I ordered them from AZ Apiaries in Connecticut.
Well, the thing is, I don't have the stinking time to do it.
Well, he does.
That's why I'm looking for somebody.
I lost all of mine.
Did you?
Yeah.
Already?
Yeah, in November. I checked out the hives.
A lot of them were
empty. I mean, I had maybe a handful of dead bees in each one. So it wasn't disease, wasn't hunger. They just left. Is that not a dwindling hive?
It's all of the above, but it's a lot of pesticides. You know where we're finding we're losing a lot of them is around golf courses in the springtime and places where they treat the lawns for grubs, because that stuff they lay down really kills bees.
Well, up on Rice Corner Road in town,
that's kind
of a couple of corn fields around. But
oh, corn. Okay, corn is where you get nailed in August, and if they're starting to die off. As soon as the corn tassels out, they start spraying. And you probably remember too, I mean, they spray up in the tassels, and if they're not spraying like after 9 o'clock at night or before daylight, the bees go after the pollen in those tassels. And it just wipes them. So it's harder and harder to do this stuff. And you don't want to be in wars with the growers, but the growers want to use the new kinds of pesticides so that they're not spraying all the time, and some of the stuff they're using is already infused in the seed.
Yeah.
Especially corn crop gets infused, so that's the only thing.
That's such a
problem. You know what they need? I just got a letter yesterday. I think they need. Did you see how many bees they need right now in the almond crop in California? It's something like thousands, 100,000, 200,000 bees. You know, hives. And what happens to those bees is those bees will go into the almond crop. They'll pull them back to like Louisiana, Georgia. And they start splitting them down into these packages or nukes and stuff. And then they sell them up to us. And
so they're all worn out by the time they get here?
I would say so. Yeah. I mean, we ordered some, what was it, a couple years ago, the guy in Maine was, we bought them off him. He was going to deliver us a bunch of nukes. And somebody stole them while we were in Florida. They were out, you know, on these fields, you know, getting fat and stuff, and somebody just came in with a flatbed and just took it, and it put them out of business, because it was, what do you have, 20,000 hives or something, they just stole them, like, bee rustlers.
That was one of those things I had always wondered about over there with the apple orchard.
They stick them out there, they drop them off. I don't know, they must drop them off with a Moffett or something, because they're always near the edge of the road there where that old fire truck is down by the...
You're talking about Brookfield, was it?
No, Honeybee, or whatever the name of it is over west, by Howard's.
Honeybee.
Oh, I don't know. They asked us to pollinate that place years and years ago. We never did. But
yeah, well, like I'm saying, the last couple of years you drive by, and there'll be a couple of pallets of hives on a pallet.
Yeah.
You know, the sprayed silver paint.
Yep.
And they got them sitting on the side of the road, and I'm assuming they're taking them out into the orchard afterwards.
The grower will pick them up on forks and
put
them where they want. They just leave them there. I think normally they just leave them and they pollinate behind the building.
Maybe that's how they get a couple of hives.
They do?
Yeah, the cobs used to drop them off.
Yeah, the card boys still do it. The mother runs the nukes and the boys run the thing. They drop off around here. I think they do Brookfield, and probably Ragged Hill, and maybe a couple other places. But we were talking about a business. There's still a business for young people with strength on high bush blueberries and stuff that don't require a big pallet of peas. You know, you can put in a half a dozen or some, spread them around, and you rent them per hive. So. Because they think you probably get a good $100 a hive now for 2 weeks rental, if not better. So, other questions or comments or?
No, this was good.
Well, you guys have been great. I appreciate it. Yeah, I'm not sure how much we told you, got you excited about this, but I appreciate you. And I didn't fall off the table once. Yeah. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.